When Stephen and I were caterers, it was our job to take and bring the restaurant to wherever people wanted it. We catered in all kinds of places, in parks, in office buildings, and all kinds of homes. We big homes, small apartments, open concept homes, not so open concept homes. And no matter where we seem to cater, the same thing always happened. People always wanted to gather in the kitchen or whatever we had made the kitchen. They would have these amazing living rooms and great rooms and fabulous dining rooms. And yet the kitchen was the place where people wanted to hang out. Now actually, it makes perfect sense because the kitchen is where the action is. And who doesn't want to be close to the action, right? There's nibbling and chatting and sipping and grazing and standing around the center island or maybe leaning against the counters, and the kitchen has that magnetic draw. Now, what was a pain for me as a caterer was actually the whole purpose of the event for the host, for people to come together, to connect, to have a common experience, to appreciate one another's company. In our own very individualistic lives, there are not many opportunities to have shared experiences. Yeah, when you're a kid, you do all kinds of things together, right? You go to school together, you ride on the bus together, you sit together, to learn, to eat, you go together to play. And that's just what happens most of the time around school. But there's also sports teams and dance lessons and student activities like clubs. But when we leave school, there are fewer gatherings. And our social time sometimes gets squeezed into the 140 characters on Twitter. Who has time for regular conversation, right? Who actually picks up those things we carry around all the time and puts it to your ear and talks? And when we do allow ourselves time, and I know I'm number one with this, we just carefully carve out an hour or two because we have been taught that quality is more important than quantity. And there's no room in our schedules for hanging out all day together. What happens is we begin to have a very pared down, individualistic life. And that isn't the way that God wired us. Instead, God wired us to live like a village, to have a community style life. And at the very core of that life is God and God's plan for us. Essentially, we long, our souls, our hearts, our beings long to be in a place where we belong. We carve out a place to be a part of a group. We want to have a place where we are accepted, where we can care for each other, and where we can be cared for. And it helps us to know that others are leading lives and having situations that are similar to ours, to have experiences that we can relate to. It may not solve anything, but it lessens our burdens to know that we are not carrying them alone, but we are carrying them with others. And this is not just a societal reality, but instead I want you to know that this is a biblical truth. And so today we are going to start a series on being community. And we're going to use that first Spirit on the day of Pentecost as the foundation for our conversation. Will you pray with me, please? Amazing God, I just ask you to open our hearts to the idea that you have created in us to be a community that is led by you. Amen. Now, our balloon reminds us of last Sunday and the theme of it, that it was Ascension Sunday. And just before Jesus ascends into heaven, he instructs his disciples to return to Jerusalem and wait. And he tells them, "And while you're waiting, do not wait alone. Do not scatter, but wait together." And so that's what they did. They waited, and they waited together. Now, this group is not the best at waiting. Now, why do I say that? Because we know in the scripture stories of the time between Easter, when Jesus was resurrected, and Ascension Day, when Jesus is brought into heaven, that there were times when Jesus came into their midst and one of them was missing. Thomas is missing when Jesus returns the first time. And then all of them go missing one day and they all go back to fishing, and actually Jesus has to go find them. But maybe there was a lesson learned, because they actually are together on Pentecost Sunday and the Holy Spirit descends. And on that day, when the Holy Spirit blows into that upper room with wind and fire, they receive a blessing. They receive that blessing as a gathered community. As we move through the book of Acts, we see how the Holy Spirit takes those who are gathered together and he creates not just a bunch of people who are waiting together in a room, but instead a community. And later that community really does life together. It tells us that they eat together, and they worship together, and they share all of that they own together. And so we see that this community is not just a stagnated, closed little club, but instead, people are attracted and drawn to be a part of what they see going on there. If you looked at the front page of the website of Simply Grace, you would see that it says, "We are a community of believers who come together, that we baptize together, and we break bread together, and we praise God together," because that together is essential to who we are as a church. And this isn't a new idea, and it's an idea from 2,000 years ago from this community, because they stopped being individuals who went to the temple and worshiped and sacrificed, and they became a community. And together they were empowered by the Holy Spirit. Together they witnessed to the faith that they received. Together they watched their numbers be increased by God. Then others were brought to faith. And before that day was over, the day of the wind and the fire, that group of 120 becomes a community of 3,000. Now, being a pastor of a group that was one time about 25 people and then growing to the group of 200 and some who call Simply Grace their home, I know that Peter or Paul could not, or Peter or John, they could not do this work on their own. Instead, they needed communities, small groups to come together to nurture and to care for one another. Today, we point to this day 2,000 years ago. And does anyone else know what today is considered besides Pentecost? It's considered the birthday of the church. That the church that God has called forth is born on this day. That a community of Jesus followers gathered together become such a strong movement that they remain strong today. And so that same Holy Spirit that came washing in with wind and fire on that day 2,000 years ago comes to this world today. And I believe God wants us to wait together. Wait together in order for us to be able to do the things he empowered that first church to do, so that God can speak to us and teach us, so that God can heal us and instruct us and correct us and forgive us and restore us and celebrate with us. We, the church, are blessed to be together. Because that togetherness allows us to encourage one another. It allows us to pray together and love one another, to break bread together. And it only works if each person who is a part of the group gathering, if they use the gift that they have been given to build up this body that we call Christ Church. Because we're all in it together, one community. Now, we're all wired a little different. So maybe all this togetherness might seem a bit much for you. Or maybe you've never been all that deeply connected with a group. And so, you wish for that, but you don't know how to go about getting it. Or maybe you once did have a special group of friends in your lives in which you shared life together, and then something happens. And you're in a different situation in life, or you've moved. There are times in life when it seems really natural for us to come together. In the days after someone passes away, we gather together. Whenever there's a tragedy, we know in the wake of those tragedies, like Hurricane Sandy, it gathers people together. But what happens is when the crisis passed, we get back to our busy, unattached lives. And that isn't God's plan for us. Today's reading invites us to recognize that all people are called to be bound together by the Holy Spirit as a community of believers that makes us together be able to witness to the transforming power of God's Holy Spirit. More than likely, if you came into this place, you might have come into this place alone, but the reason that you keep returning to this place is not because of the solitude that you find here, but instead because of the community that has welcomed you. That first community, the Holy Spirit drew together people of all different backgrounds and languages and people who had very different stories. They were of different ages, they had diverse gifts, and different abilities and skills to follow him. The purpose for our gathering together is because we love God, and we want to grow in our faith and our service to God. But as important as it is to love God, we need to also love others. Therefore, we build our lives together. And it is in this knitting together that it will allow us to best serve God and one another and the world. Being a community that gathers together on Sunday is absolutely important. But if we do not intentionally connect in gathering together in other times, well, then what happens is that our worship gathering, well, I read this scenario and I actually kind of made something click. Because what it makes our worship gathering on Sunday is no different than waiting in a terminal at an airport. Yes, we come together and the passengers are all going to the same place, and hopefully we're all going to the same place too. And then, yeah, they sit close to each other, and actually in the terminal and at an airport, you sit closer than you sit in a church together. And yet what happens is, in an airport terminal, we remain anonymous. And at the very most, you have some little superficial conversation. I actually read that there's like all kinds of instructions that if you want to be left alone traveling, what you do. Like, you put in your earbuds and you wear sunglasses and you look down a lot, and that way no one will talk to you. And at first I was like, oh, this is hysterical. This is me at the airport. But then I realized, you know, this is us at church often too. We come in and we are fearful of someone seeing something in our heart and our soul. And so even though we might not have our earbuds on, we give signals of, give me my space. Yeah. What happens is that in church, it has to be different than a trip to the airport. Because who likes going to the airport, really? Instead, we need to fully invest in our lives together with one another. It can be hard to commit to community, especially if you're the kind of person who is guarded or prefers solitude, and I get that. But community is God's desire for us. And it's a sign of mature faith. Because at the end of the day, when we grow in our relationship with others, what will happen is we will grow in our relationship with God. When we wait together as Jesus commanded, then we will encounter God together in our worship and in our work, and in our prayer times, in our gathering together for fun as well as gathering together to make difficult decisions. And there will be no limits to the good things that will take place because Pentecost will be happening. It is my desire that Simply Grace becomes a Pentecostal church. A church that opens themselves to the movement of the Holy Spirit, to the guidance of Jesus Christ, and to the power of God. That we wait together, and that we wait so that we receive that gift of the Holy Spirit. So I want you to consider, who is God calling you to wait with?